How long is this episode?
6 hours.
6 hours. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Chemists in the Kitchen. Today, we all made breakfast, and we have a huge mess on our hands. We're going to be talking about the chemistry of cleaning.
We all have some household cleaners that we want to try. Things like vinegar, lemon, and lime, and baking soda, and we'll see how effective they are in cleaning.
Hi, my name is Natasha. I am an organic chemist, and I currently run an undergraduate research program at the University of Arizona. Organic chemists like to make and break things. That's going to be really helpful here.
Hi, my name is Sudeep Agarwala. I'm a synthetic biologist and a yeast geneticist, which means that I'm not only a pretty snazzy baker, but also at the cutting edge of biotechnology. I have a lot of experience with chemistry and how to manipulate organisms to make different natural products.
So my name is Adrian. I'm a physical scientist or physical chemist that works at a medical device company. What I focus on are interactions between materials, and that will be very useful in trying to understand how things clean.
Why is this an interesting episode to talk about, right? I have my Dawn cuts grease, and I have Barkeeper's Friend, all these favorite products. But what are they actually doing, and what are they doing to the material that we use to clean our house? What we're going to talk about today is the actual chemistry, why these things are effective and how they're effective. We'll take it back down to basic principles, using very simple chemicals inside of our house to recreate those effects.
We essentially did cook to start everything off, but really the next question is really like, what do you do after? And so there's a richness of chemistry as opposed to the part where we're making things and putting stuff together. This one's more breaking stuff.
I have a coffee cup that's clean, but I can see all of like the coffee stains on the bottom of it, right? That's, you know, we can figure out how to do clean in the sense of no color impurities. We can do this from just stuff that we have laying around our house. We don't need to go to the store and get every single cleaning product in order to make something usable again, yeah, or get rid of impurities in something.
The reason I usually turn to household cleaners is because I'm lazy or because I'm disorganized and I have a really smelly kitchen and I'm out of soap, and I make do with what I have to make it smell nice, to make it look cleaner without having to run to the store and drop that cash.
Was just really thinking about what is the appropriate thing to clean the thing that I want, knowing what not to mix. You know, there's, yes, always this constant thing about ammonia and bleach, and they taught that to me in grade school of like not mixing ammonia and bleach, and that gets reiterated in high school when you're doing lab chemistry and so forth. So I guess we're here not to endorse any particular type of cleaning, but for you to be engaged to think about how would I clean things in my own kitchen. What did everybody make this morning?
I made oatmeal, so I have my oatmeal pot.
I think we're talking about oatmeal, a lot of starch, a lot of gelatinized starch. And what happens there is that you have these long chains of sugars that sort of like mesh together into this impenetrable coating. So we're gonna try to clean that.
Yeah, the same thing. We all kind of had the same idea of making the same breakfast. So I did start out with something starchy. So I made steel cut oats.
I made sausage and bacon, and I have this greasy, greasy pan.
I made eggs also, so I have my spatula and my trusty cast iron.
Then the other thing is made pork, pork sausages. So you can see the ring in here, and you're not on camera, but this stuff stinks. But as you can see in the pan here, made 5 sausages just for show. And then this pan is also disgusting.
Just like a true American, I have my coffee cup with my coffee stain in it.
I don't drink coffee, but I did leave some tea out, so there's some stain in there. So
I have my vinegar, acid, and baking soda as a base, and I have some fruit. I have my lemon, and I have limes as well that we can use.
So I would love to start, I think, with the coffee cups.
What's the idea here, right? A, why is it stained? That's the first part. And the second part is what are each of these ingredients kind of fall in that material family? One's an acid, one's a base.
Yeah, so the things in coffee that cause stains are called tannins. But these are, they're called polyphenols. They're water soluble, but they can get caught in the pores of your ceramic cup. And so what the acid or base or whatever we're using can do is it can help to pull those out of the ceramic pores. I would like one person to use baking soda, one person to use citrus, and one person to use vinegar.
Okay.
Take your pick.
Sudeep, you want to try the baking soda? I'll try, yeah, squeezing some lemon in here. Put that in there.
For me, I just made a paste out of the baking soda. Gee, honestly, I was not surprised. I was not expecting this, but this is working amazing.
The citrus works in terms of like, well, I think the first thing that I observed was There is probably like a very superficial kind of stain in the coffee cup to begin with. And those stains are the ones that kind of got out the most. But then there's still like residue that's still left over.
I'm gonna be honest, I'm not really seeing much of anything on my end. But now that I'm adding some of the metal scrubbing pad, it's coming off like it's nothing. But that was like the, Adrian, like you were saying, superficial stain. For the one that was a little more caked in there, I'm not really seeing anything happen for this one.
I am astounded. No, I mean, maybe it's the fact that it's actually a powder and you have to rub it on there. But when you add a little bit of water, you start to see it bubble up a little bit with the stains on the edge. That's not good.
Oh, nice.
That's not good tape. But it turns brown. And I actually do wonder if it has something to do with an acid base reaction. It sort of fizzes up the same way that you'd expect to see it fizz up when you add vinegar to baking soda.
So tannins are like acidic, like they're acidic compounds, mildly acidic, and so using the base would neutralize that, which would make sense why you're seeing the bubbles.
I'm actually kind of really shocked by how easily that can the rest of us try baking soda really quickly?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can.
I'm just like absolutely astounded. So what I did is I put in like a tablespoon and then added equal amount of water and just used my finger to rub that paste around. Okay. And like what I observed is that it's kind of like a miracle cleaner getting rid of all of that.
No, I think it's effective. Like, I can actually see some of the other stains start to go. So, but yeah, it does look a little bit whiter. So that worked. I think, what do we gain from that?
There's a lot of different ways that we can remove tannin stains. Tannin stains are removable with an acid or a base. I probably wouldn't reach for the vinegar because mine didn't seem like it worked as well as Adrian's did.
What I have here is a very disgusting pan. It's not super disgusting. I mean, what do we think we can use to kind of clean this?
I also have a greasy pan. Grease, you know, is just fat, right? Like it's oil, it's fat. So saponification is how we actually make soap. And what that does is we use something basic, something like sodium bicarb that makes those OHs, and we can break down the fats and make them soluble in water. Because right now we can't rinse this off, right? It's not gonna be soluble in water. If we break it down somehow or we cut it up, then we should be able to wash it away.
What else is going on in those pans is that there's protein stains on there. So you have this Maillard reaction. Especially in Adrian's pan, I saw those those patty prints before, and that's burnt on protein that's really tough to get out.
So let's talk about our cookware for a little bit. So I'm using stainless steel. There is no coating on here whatsoever. You might have coatings on yours, or you might have something on there that might make this job a little bit easier.
Like true, I have a nonstick. This is like, I think it's a Teflon coating on top, so it's to help things like not stick to it.
You have these reused cast iron metal pans that form these polymers of fat on the surface that make it a sort of nonstick surface.
We've talked about things that are sticking to each other, and in this pan it's like greasy, oily fats. Water doesn't seem to like anything, so if we put olive oil in water, those things don't like each other. But if you put a little bit of soap in water with olive oil, what do you guys see?
The olive oil sort of dissolves into the water, right?
So that's a different approach in sort of the acid base kind of idea. Soap is a surfactant and it has this thing where it likes something oily and it likes something that likes something like water. It's the great connector, kind of like egg. It's like eggs. And so it pulls those things together and then pulls them in a way that actually you can kind of like form a larger mass, and that makes it easier for like kind of the mechanical scrubbing part. I do want to try the baking soda, but then the question I had was baking soda is an acid or a base. Vinegar is an acid, and we all know what happens when you add those two together. And I'm just curious, is that going to be better for cleaning if we combine those two together? Because I've often heard as baking soda and acid, or baking soda and vinegar combined will actually help with a greasy pan and remove things better than just baking soda or vinegar alone.
I just have a feeling that it's going to look very dramatic, but not actually do much.
I feel like that's a challenge that we can try. So I'm willing to do that. Take a baking soda and vinegar, or we can do, and then one person does vinegar and one person does baking soda. So we've got that acid base, and then a combination of the two.
I'm gonna stick with baking soda. I nominate Adrian for the combo because he was very excited about seeing.
That's fine.
Yeah.
I have to say, I'm turning into a big fan of baking soda. This is great.
I will say the citrus adds a delightful scent to the cleaning process.
So this is great, right? Like from a visual test, the grease seems to have really gone with the baking soda, but they're stuck on protein onto the dish still. In order to clean that off, I'm just gonna need to scrub it. You can start to see the white where the baking soda interacts with the grease.
I would say that the solution though of this baking soda and vinegar has taken off some of the brown color or some of the grease.
That's really interesting.
More so than the water. Also can see Yeah, a separation. I can see that there's oily things, components, that are in the solution itself.
Mine's working also very well. I just added rubbing alcohol to mine just to like do a little test. Rubbing alcohol is definitely turning a color, but it's not really cutting down any of the grease from what I can see.
So I have to say, the mechanical is really what cleaned up my pan. That's not a surprise.
What do we gain from this kind of experiment here?
I think that they can all have the desired effect. It just depends on how you use them, right? And like in what context you're using them. I'm looking at this right now and I want to try the vinegar and like hot water to see if like that helps speed things up a bit, you know?
Should we move on to something else? Try the last thing, something really starchy.
Starch.
Gross, disgusting, yeah.
I'm not gonna lie, I'm like the least excited to clean this pan because it's looking dire in here.
Pretty rough, right?
Yeah, it's looking pretty rough.
Or you do what you did in college with when living with roommates and just let it soak for a few weeks.
But even in that idea, right? Why is it that we just let it soak? What are we really trying to do there? You're effectively saying that water can be a cleaner just in general of itself, just by letting it soak. So what's the idea behind that?
Gelatinized carbohydrate that needs to rehydrate, you need to give it time. So you could either let it soak or you could boil it with hot water to speed up that process. That's what's going on, right?
It just likes water more, but it does take time. As in like, it takes time for water molecules to interact with like these long starchy molecules. I mean, I'm just gonna try that method. It's just water, just seeing how effective water is in general, just to clean something before we move on to something else. But I guess the first start is like, you talked about mechanical agitation. So what if we just try water and just mechanical agitation and just ask ourselves is how good does that get before we really need anything?
Yeah, sure.
All right,
okay, yeah, let's try it.
Now that I'm using my little wire scrubby thing, it's actually kind of like tearing it apart because it's like so hard. And things are coming off. The interaction with the side of the pan is definitely being disrupted, but I either need more time or I need something else.
We don't see anything with like that acid and base with the chemistry, with the lemon or the baking soda. We do know something's working, right? Because we actually remove it. But I think also from our training itself is that we also know that highly acidic and highly basic environments are not favorable to, let's say, bacteria or any types of little microbes. And so I would trust for cleaning, having to make a condition where it's really unfavorable to living things. I'd still want some kind of confirmation or do some other process to really clean this the way that I think it needs to be cleaned. Mostly mine, this is clean too for me, like visually, right? I don't see any debris. But it's that last part about like cleaning a surface level, but it's also kind of like at a microscopic level that we have to think about.
I added soap and I feel much, much safer with this pan.
Feeling better about it.
I think overall, we didn't actually try a lot of formulation to me. We actually just tried what was here off the shelf, which really just says it's like, there's some combination of other these things that are safe, but it really doesn't take much.
With disrupting whatever interaction is making it quote unquote dirty for us, right? Like how can we disrupt the interaction? How can we get off what's visible to us and then also clean it at the microscopic level and feel like we can reuse the dish? Yeah, so I think today, you know, I'm like, we did a lot. You know, we talked about what does clean mean to us? And we figured out how we could use, you know, things that are around the house to have desired effects of store-bought cleaners. It comes down to, you know, how do we disrupt the interaction that we don't want, the interaction that's making it stick to the pan or stick to the cup or whatever that is. And then how can we actually wash it away and make it clean for ourselves, whether that be with soap or making it smell fun or however that looks like to you.
I just wanted to add one thing that I'm very excited to finally have cleaned up everything from breakfast. It's kind of driving me nuts.
Natasha, can you do like a fireworks or an explosion so you can send us out?
How do Does I do work? This? I don't know how to make it work. Like I don't know.
Clap? Does that do it?
Yeah, clap. Yeah.
No.
Okay, well,
sorry.
They'll add that in, so. This has been a wonderful episode of Chemists in the Kitchen. So we will talk to everybody later. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.